The White and the Gold by Thomas B. Costain. Introduction. There have been many histories of Canada, and some of them have been truly fine, but it seemed to a group of writers, all of whom were Canadians or of Canadian stock, who met a few years ago, that the time had come for something different. We all felt the need for a version which would neglect none of the essential factors, but would consider more the lives of the people, the little people, as well as the spectacular characters who made history, and tell the story with due conscientiousness of the green, romantic, immense, moving, and mysterious background which Canada provides. In addition, there was a strong feeling, and this clearly was the governing impulse, that Canada's rise to nationhood should be traced to the present day, when the land which was once New France, and then the Dominion of Canada, promises to develop into one of the great powers of the globe. This, it will be allowed at once, was what might be termed a rather tall order. However, there was considerable discussion about it, both then and later, and the outcome was a plan to do a formidably long version, all the way from John Cabot to Saint Laurent. It was to be the joint work of a number of Canadian writers, one for each volume, and perhaps as many as 6 volumes. It fell to my lot to begin, and this volume tells the story of the earliest days, the period of the French regime, concluding near the end of the 17th century. It has been with me a labour of love. Almost from the first I found myself caught in the spell of those courageous, colourful, cruel days. But whenever I found myself guilty of overstressing the romantic side of the picture and forgetful of the more prosaic life beneath, I tried to balance the scales more properly, to stop at the small house of the habitant, to look in the brave and rather pathetic chapel in the wilderness, to stare inside the bare and smoky barracks of the French regulars. It is, at any rate, a conscientious effort at a balanced picture of a period which was brave, bizarre, fanatical, lyrical, lusty, and, in fact, rather completely unbalanced. No bibliography is appended because I found, when the time came to prepare one, that the point of no return had been reached. A list of roughly 1,000 items, books, papers, extracts, manuscripts, which had been read, or at least dipped into, would be of small value because of its very size. I shall content myself, therefore, with the perhaps obvious statement that in writing of this period, 2 great sources constitute a large part of the preparation, that uniquely conceived and organized mass of remarkable material, the Jesuit Relations, and the crystal-clear reconstruction in Francis Parkman's splendid volumes. The second volume, which will deal with the period of the English and French Wars, is now being prepared by Joseph Lister Rutledge, for many years editor of the Canadian Magazine, and a fine scholar, with the capacity to keep a great event equally great in the telling. Thomas B. Costain, January 1, 1954. The White and the Gold, Chapter 1. John Cabot speaks to a king, and discovers a continent. 1. It may seem strange to begin a history of Canada in an English city, a bustling maritime centre of narrow streets in a pocket of the hills where the Avon joins the Severn. But that is where the story rightly starts, in the city of Bristol, which had become second only to London in size, and was doing a thriving trade with Ireland and Gascony, and that cold, distant island called Iceland, which the Norsemen had discovered. It starts in Bristol because a Genoese sailor, after living some time in London, had settled there with his wife and 3 sons, one John Cabot, or Cabute, as the official record spells it, a sea captain and master pilot of some small reputation. He arrived in Bristol about 1490, when the place was fairly bristling with prosperity, and the streets had been paved with stone, and the High Cross had been painted and gilded most elaborately, and out on Redcliffe Street the Rudd House stood with its great square tower, the home of those fabulous commoners, the Cannings, as evidence of the wealth which could be gained in trade. It was not strange that little attention was paid at first to this dark-complexioned, soft-spoken foreigner. Bristol, aggressive and alive to everything, had been fitting out ships to explore the western seas in search of the Vinland of the Norse sagas and the legendary Island of the Seven Cities, which had been found and settled more than 7 centuries before by an archbishop of Oporto fleeing the conquering Moors with 6 other bishops. The waterfront buzzed with the strange new talk which had been on the tongues of sailors for years. the suddenly aroused speculation as to what lay beyond the grey horizon of the turbulent Atlantic. The men of Bristol doffed their flat sea caps to no one. What had they to learn from a mariner who knew only the indolent ease of southern seas, most particularly of the Mediterranean, where the levesque blew insistently across from Africa with a dank, hot scent? But then it became known that another of these bland-tongued fellows, one Christopher Columbus, had set sail westward from Spain with three small ships, and had found land hundreds of leagues across the grey waters, and that because of this Ferdinand and Isabella of Spain were claiming all the trade of Cathay. Bristol recalled that this man, John Cabot, had been voicing the same theories which had induced their most Christian majesties to gamble a fleet on such a thin prospect. Cabot also had said that the world was round, and that the shortest route to Cathay and Cipango led straight west. They got out their charts and compasses now, and with new respect listened to him expound his belief that where Columbus had landed was the midriff of Asia, and that the way around the world would be found far to the north. This was heady talk. It meant that there were still lands and seas to which Spain could not yet lay claim, that the flag of England could lead the way to equal wealth and glory. It was decided to seek royal sanction for a venture well to the north of the route which the inspired Columbus had taken. Henry VII was King of England at this time, and he was not exactly popular in Bristol. In the year 1490, he had paid the city a ceremonial visit and had received a truly royal welcome, but on leaving he had shocked them by laying a fine of 5% on all men worth in excess of £20. Their wives, he said, had broken some dusty and long-forgotten sumptuary law by dressing themselves finely in his honour. He had called this fine a benevolence, but the outspoken Bristol men had found other words for it. The seventh Henry, in point of fact, had little gift for winning the hearts of his subjects. The first of the Tudor kings was able and far-seeing, but he was cold, withdrawn, hating no man but loving none, incapable of much enthusiasm save for the gold he was accumulating through the efficient raking of the legal fork of Morton, his chief minister. Henry was eager, it developed, to share in the spoils of the West, and so letters patent were issued to John Cabute and his three sons, Louis, Sebastian, and Sanchez, to set sail with five ships, to be paid for with their own money, and to seek out, discover, and find whatsoever islands, continents, regions, and provinces of the heathens and infidels in whatever part of the world they be, which before this time have been unknown to all Christians. It was stipulated that they were to raise the flag of England over any new lands they found, and to acquire dominion, title, and jurisdiction over these towns, castles, islands, and mainlands so discovered. The only restriction laid upon them seems to have been that they must not venture into the south, where they would be poaching on the Spanish domain. The parsimonious king had carefully protected himself from any possible loss, but he stipulated nevertheless that he was to receive 1/5 of any profits which might accrue. It was provided in return that the Cabutes were to have as their reward a monopoly of trading privileges, and that Bristol was to benefit by being the sole port of entry for any ships which engaged in the western trade. This laid the financial responsibility squarely in the laps of the men of Bristol, and it was not until the following year that they were able to organise their resources for the effort. Early in May 1497, a single ship called the Matthew, a ratty little caravel, set out for the west with John Cabot in command and a crew of 18 men, surely the meanest of equipment with which to make such a hazardous and important venture. It was with stout hearts and high hopes, nevertheless, that the little crew gazed ahead over the swelling waters of the Atlantic, their paddles well tallowed and their topmasts struck to the cap in the expectation, nay the certainty, of rough weather ahead. In the 15th century, the mariner had few instruments to guide him on his course. When the weather was clear, he could sail with his eye fixed on the North Star. If it was overcast, he had to use the compass. The North Atlantic is more likely to provide fogs and grey skies than clear sunshine, and so it was the compass on which John Cabot had to depend. This meant that he did not sail due west, for the compass has its little failings and never points exactly north. In the waters through which Cabot was sailing, the variation is west of north, which meant that the tiny Matthew, wallowing in the trough of the sea, its lateen sail always damp with the spray, followed a course which inclined slightly southward. This was fortunate. It spared the crew any contact with the icebergs, which would have been encountered in great numbers had they sailed due west, and it brought them finally, on June the 24th, 1497, to land, which has been identified since as Cape Breton Island. The anchor was dropped, and the little band went ashore gratefully, their hearts filled with bounding hopes. The new land was warm and green and fertile. Trees grew close to the water's edge. The sea, which abounded with fish, rolled into a strip of sandy shingle. They saw no trace of natives, but the fact that some of the trees had been felled was evidence that the country was inhabited. All doubts on that score ended when snares for the catching of game were found. Perhaps eyes distended with excitement were watching the newcomers from the safe cover of the trees, but not a sound warned of their surveillance. John Cabot, raising a high wooden cross with the flag of England and the banner of St. Mark's of Venice, that city having granted him citizenship some years before, had no reservations at all. He was certain he had accomplished his mission. He knew that his feet were planted firmly on the soil of Cathay, that fabulous land of spices and silks and gold. Somewhere hereabouts he would find the great open passage through which ships would sail north of Cathay and so in time girdle the earth. 2. It is unfortunate that so many of the great men of early Canadian history are little else but names. John Cabot, who thus had become the discoverer of North America, is wrapped almost completely in the mists of the past. A few dates, a phrase or two from letters of the period, an odd detail shining out of the darkness like a welcome ray of sunshine, these make up the sum total of what is known about him. There is no record of his appearance, whether he was tall or short, stocky or thin. His nationality suggests that he was dark of complexion, but even this remains pure speculation. It is not known when and where he died, although it is assumed that he spent his last days in Bristol. This much is known, that he and his faithful 18, all of whom seem to have returned alive, were given a tumultuous welcome in Bristol, and that all England joined later in the chorus of acclaim. Cabot became at once a national hero. He was called the Great Admiral, and wherever he went, according to a letter written by a Venetian merchant residing in London, the English ran after him like mad people. He seems to have had a broad streak of vanity in him, because he began to dress himself handsomely in silks, and, presumably, to affect the grand manner. He distributed conditional largesse with a lavish hand, granting an island, to be chosen and occupied later, to this one, a strip of land to another. He gave it out rather grandiloquently that the priests who had volunteered to accompany the second expedition were all to be made bishops in the new land. From these details it may be assumed that he strutted and posed and made the most of his brief moment of glory. That much may be said without detracting from the credit due him. He had been cast in the mould of greatness. Before Columbus set out, John Cabot had been expressing the same beliefs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.